Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Thank you very much. I'm really excited to be back, and I'm excited to talk about some of the work we've been doing at Duke. We're rethinking systems management with game theory. And why are we taking first a game theoretic perspective? Well, you could imagine the best case scenario where you have altruistic individuals contributing their spare cycles for the good of science, right? So maybe you're doing study at home or folding at home. And in that scenario, you've got people who want to contribute to science and they're willing to run distributed applications on their own personal machines. In most cases, you don't have this particular setting. You have a system or a setting more like this. You have competitive groups, the healthy competition, competing for a finite set of resources. And this has been true since the early, since the late 90s with DOE machines, high performance capability machines. And it's increasingly true now with web-based applications. And in these settings, we have cost-efficient capability. That's why we share. But we're relying on centralized scheduling, and we're seeing increasingly sophisticated schedulers that users might try to game or opt out of. So the question is, how do we manage resources in this setting when we're sharing at scale? So let's simplify the problem. Here's Alice and Bob, and they're working on two different projects. They have different tasks, they have different deadlines, so they might be amenable to sharing. They both have $100,000 each to buy IT equipment. What should they do? Well, suppose also that Alice and Bob are strategic. If they're strategic, because they're strategic, they're going to ask this question, which is better? Should we pool our resources together to buy a large shared cluster, or should we buy smaller separate machines and manage them on our own? Right. Suppose Alice and Bob share, then the question is the allocation coming out of the system fair? If not, I might walk away with my machines. Alternatively, is lying beneficial? Can I misreport what I need from the system or game the queuing framework and try to get more than my fair share of the resources? So this is the setting we're looking at. So this is point one of this talk. Competition between strategic users defines the nature of shared systems. Strategic users we define in two ways. First, they're pursuing performance selfishly without regard for others. And second, they have the ability, they reserve the right to opt out when management outcomes are unfair. Opting out means bypassing the centralized scheduling policy. Opting out might mean pulling your hardware out of the system and running it independently on your own. So we address this problem by looking at fairness despite strategic behavior, and this work appeared in ASPLOS 14, where we allocate resources with incentive and fairness guarantees. So what does this mean? Resource elasticity fairness is our approach. The first property of resource elasticity fairness is that we want sharing incentives. This means that users are guaranteed to perform no worse than if they got an equal share of the hardware. Alice would get half of the machine and perform at least as well as if she had half the machine. Bob would perform at least as well as if he had half the machine, right? So this is a prerequisite for constructing a shared system. This is a prerequisite for participation. Second, we want envy-freeness, which is to say that Alice always prefers her allocation over Bob's, and Bob always prefers his allocation over Alice's. And this is the condition for envy-freeness, and this allows us to define what we mean by fair. Subject to these two constraints, sharing incentives and envy-freeness, we want to perform pretty well. This is Pareto efficiency. No other allocation can improve utility without harming someone in the system. So the allocation should be efficient, subject the most efficient we can get given these two constraints. And then finally, we want strategy proofness, which is to say no user can benefit from lying about what they want from the system. So the allocation mechanism we're going to talk about guarantees each of these four properties. So how do we do that? At the root of this allocation mechanism is a performance model, the Cobb-Douglas utility model. Here we have utility or performance that's expressed as a product of exponentiated allocations. So X could be, U could be IPC, task throughput, whatever you'd like. X is the resource allocation like cache allocation, bandwidth allocation, et cetera. We're gonna raise it to some power and we're gonna multiply all of this together. It turns out that this utility function really fits really well preferences in computer architecture. I'm a computer architect. First, Cobb-Douglas allows us to capture diminishing marginal returns, really important if you want to look at Amdahl's law, for example. The alphas and the exponentiation gives you nonlinear models. The products help you model substitution effects. So if I give you less of one resource, maybe I can compensate you with more of another resource, cache and bandwidth, for example. And you can see that by taking the partial derivative of u with respect to one of the x's and seeing that it depends on the other x's. Right, so for those of you who are familiar with dominant resource fairness out of Berkeley, this is where we make a major departure from that work. We have nonlinear utility models, and we have substitutable goods. Right, DRF assumes linear models, and it assumes complementary goods. So this is a significant generalization of that framework. We looked at this problem for shared cache and memory controllers. So the question is, if I want to allocate memory bandwidth and cache size on a large CMP, and I have these utility functions where user 1 slightly prefers more bandwidth over cache, and user 2 really prefers cache over bandwidth, how should I do the allocation of resources for two users sharing this system? These are utility functions that we fit accurately for two parsec workloads. The space of possible allocations looks like this. We have two users. User 1 is in the lower left corner. And user 1, in this particular case, gets 6 gigabytes per second of bandwidth and 8 megs of last level cache. User 2 gets the rest. User 2 gets 18 gigabytes per second of bandwidth and 4 megs of cache. Right? So this is a feasible allocation. And any point in this space is a feasible allocation. So what are the fair allocations in this setting? Well, the first question is, what are the envy-free allocations? If I ask user 1, what allocation should I give you such that you are not envious, user 1 will respond, give me any allocation in the blue region, and I will be envy-free. That is because user 1 derives more utility from her allocation than the utility that she gets from the other person's allocation. So that's the blue region here. The red region here is user 2 saying, if you give me any allocation in this space, I will not be envious. So if we take all of these together, we can combine them and say fairness is no user being envious and Pareto efficiency, which are all of the allocations on this contract curve here. So this is the set of all fair allocations in the space of cache size and memory bandwidth allocations for our system. How do we find these fair allocations? We have a simple four-step mechanism called REF to get to this approach. The first is, of course, profiling. We're going to need to construct our utility model. Second, we're going to fit our utility function. So this is also pretty simple. We take a log transformation on both sides. This turns into a linear model, and we find the alphas with regression. So the profiles will give us performance for a variety of allocations. The only thing we don't know are the alphas. We go ahead and fit those. And we can do it accurately for a range of parsec workloads. Third, we normalize elasticity. So if we fitted elasticities 0.2 and 0.3, we scale them up so that they sum to 1. This simply allows us to compare different users' elasticities on the same scale. And the last step is what I'm really excited about, because the allocation is really simple when you get to this point. You simply allocate in proportion to elasticities. So if user 1 has an elasticity of 0.6 for memory bandwidth and user 2 has an elasticity of 0.2 for memory bandwidth, user 1 simply gets 3/4 of the total, and user 2 gets 1/4 of the total. And it turns out that if you apply all four of these steps, we guarantee all four of those game theoretic desiderata that we had talked about earlier. And I can sketch the proof for you, or you can refer to the paper, but this is a strong guarantee. So that's how we allocate resources with incentive and fairness guarantees. I want to spend the last few minutes talking about the most recent work, which is decentralizing management. And I'm really glad that Sharif had spoken about a bit about power management in an earlier session, because we're looking at very much the same setting. How do you allocate resources with independent agents that produce a stable equilibrium in the system? So we refer to this as the computational sprinting game, because we're managing power and sprints in a system with a shared power supply. So sprinting is the idea of enhancing performance briefly with extra power. Our notion of a sprint is 3 cores at 1.2 gigahertz, getting boosted up to 12 cores at 2.7 gigahertz. We looked at this notion of a sprint for a range of Apache Spark workloads, and we saw a speed up somewhere between 2 and 6x at a cost of 50% in power and a cost of maybe 20% in thermal effects. So the idea behind sprinting is, when should processes sprint? If I have a rack of data centers, 1,000, maybe a couple of hundred processors, which when should processors sprint? That this depends on application phase behavior. Which processor should sprint? This depends on how many other processors are sprinting and who benefits most. So over time, maybe I'm in a particular time period and my utility from these sprints will vary over time. At this particular point in time, I need to decide whether or not I want to sprint. And I don't know what my utility is necessarily in the future, so I need to be strategic about this decision. If I sprint now, I'm going to have to wait some amount of time for the chip to cool. And if I trip the circuit breaker, I'm going to have to wait for even longer for the UPS to kick in to allow the computation to proceed and for the batteries to recharge for normal operation. So users are going to be strategic not only in terms of selfishly pursuing performance, but also navigating these constraints with respect to power draw. We have three desiderata in this setting. We want distributed action. We don't want the agents, as Sharif mentioned earlier, we don't want the agents to have to go back to the centralized coordinator before every sprint. We're sprinting, we decide to sprint on the order of microseconds, but communicating with the manager requires milliseconds across the network. So we want agents to be able to decide to sprint independently and strategically to maximize performance. Second, we want to maximize individual performance. Agents will care only about their performance. They don't worry about the rest of the system. And we want system stability, which is, given that we've maximized utility, these strategies will produce an equilibrium. All agents are playing their best response in this game, and we're going to produce a stable system. So how do we do this? Well, first, we define the sprinting game. The sprinting game is defined by three states. You're either in an active state in which you can sprint, or you're in a cooling state where you've just sprinted and you're waiting for the chip to cool, or you're in a recovery state where you've tripped the circuit breaker or someone else has tripped the circuit breaker and the batteries are recharging. The actions are to sprint or not to sprint when you're in the active state. Now, we optimize gameplay in this setting by using a solution concept called mean field equilibria. The idea is that maybe we have 1,000 agents in the system, but we don't need to reason about each individual agent and what they're doing. We specify a statistical distribution on their behaviors, and then each agent will optimize against those expectations. Right. So as an example, the equilibrium threshold is going to be sprinting if you're active and if your utility from doing so is greater than some threshold. And this threshold will differ from workload to workload. Linear regression sets a threshold at about 2x. I'm going to sprint if I expect my gain to be greater than 2. PageRank often sprints to get a gain of 4x, but sometimes it might get a gain of greater than 10x. So it's going to be strategic, and it's going to sprint, set a threshold higher, so it's going to wait for these periods where it's going to benefit most from those sprints. The key idea here is that the system is in equilibrium. The agents are playing their best responses. No agent benefits from deviating from the responses that we find. So this means we don't need centralized enforcement. We simply broadcast these strategies. And even if they wanted to deviate, they wouldn't get any better performance from their deviation. I'll close by saying that this approach, this equilibrium strategy, performs well. This performs a lot better than a greedy approach where everyone sprints at the earliest opportunity. It performs better than an exponential backoff approach where you back off once you trigger a power emergency. And it performs competitively with some sort of globally optimized or oracular solution. Right? The equilibrium reflects strategic and distributed play. Agents are deciding independently whether or not to sprint. And to illustrate the stability, my last slide will simply say that if you're greedy, the number of sprinters will very often exceed what is safe for the system, shown in the red. If you have some sort of back-off mechanism after you trigger a power emergency, you're going to be conservative and you're going to leave performance on the table. But here, with these threshold strategies, you're able to sprint. Sometimes you'll incur a power emergency, but you have UPS to protect you and safeguard the power delivery system, and you're getting good performance out of the system. So in summary, we think that shared systems are defined by competition between strategic users, selfishly pursuing performance, opting out if they don't like what they get. And we have allocation policies that guarantee fairness and allocation policies that allow us to find equilibria and implement decentralized management. Thanks so much.
Time for one question. Yes. Boris?
Really cool stuff, Ben. So I understand how Gilman you know, placement of tasks onto a machine, you are doing, you know, the sort of equilibrium finding, right? But now, globally speaking, can you do better by actually driving certain placements? Because, I mean, it's a bin packing problem, right, basically, because you can actually fit more things better than otherwise.
Right, so bin packing is a globally optimal solution, or it's a heuristic to try to find a globally optimal solution. And in general, when you try to find a good solution, you could either do a centralized optimization approach or you can do a distributed multi-agent approach. So we've taken the latter. So we're hoping that the agents will converge to a desirable system outcome. Roughly speaking, you can expect some sort of performance loss there. That's the price of anarchy, right? A dictator dictating exactly who should do what should outperform agents independently deciding what to do. What we showed on one of our performance graphs is that the gap is pretty small, at least for our setting.
Thanks, Ben. More time. Now we have Adam Wierman from Caltech.
Great, thanks. So this is a fun topic for me to talk about because it's the first time I've talked about this outside of Caltech. So it's a new thing for our group and something that we will be working on for a while. So it's a great chance for me to get feedback from you all. So afterwards, ask questions and come up to me and chat. Basically, you know, at this point, it's old hat to say that data has become a commodity. I mean, heck, it's been on the cover of Time. You know, our data is being bought and sold around us all the time. There, you know, data is something like oil or corn as a, you know, there's a market surrounding it now. But what this talk and the research that we're doing is about is really what I think is the next step, which is that data is going to move from a commodity to a service. And what I mean by that language is the same thing that we all, you know, lived through in computing infrastructure. So infrastructure today is not a commodity anymore. It used to be that you bought, you know, as a startup, you bought your own, you know, data center, you built it, you owned it, you moved through it. Today, you rent it, right? You rent it, you scale it as you need, and this provides a lot of benefits in terms of manageability, efficiency, and performance, and all these things. But it's a service. It's something different than a commodity. And I think, you know, over the next 5 years, the same thing's going to happen to data. And you see this already starting in a wide variety of places. So you see it both in startups. So my favorite of the startups to talk about is Factual, because it's a Caltech alums startup. So Gil Elbez is running it. And this is a company that basically, you know, their goal is to be the world's data steward. They're starting with one vertical around location-based information. And basically, you know, they've promised to never build an app. They're a clearinghouse for data for location services, and they provide the data underneath Uber and almost every, you know, major startup that uses location information. And you probably haven't heard of them unless you're in this space. But they're negotiating these contracts and providing, in some sense, cloud-based access to data every time you use Uber. Big companies are doing this as well. Oracle has a big entry in here, but since we're at Microsoft, I should focus on Azure. So Azure has their own data marketplace. And if you look at, you know, the marketplace, there's 50 or 60 different data sets that you can buy access to in different ways for different rates per month, depending on how much you're going to access them. But, you know, this is still, you buy it and then you have access. It's not integrated into the cloud in an organic way, the same way we have the ability to rent and ramp up compute instances and memory and these sorts of things. And that's, I think, our vision. Our vision is that in 5 years, something like this will be the menu. So the top half is Azure today. The bottom half is, you know, something that you could imagine adding on, where now when you rent your instance, you decide what data you want to have access to, what quality you want that access at, what locations you want that access to be available at what performance guarantees, and you just add it on to your instance as part of the service that you're renting. Now, getting there, obviously, is a big challenge. So in some sense, you know, what you have there is you have a data cloud that's geo-distributed that has to be built. It has to be an aggregator for data not just from Microsoft, but from tons of different providers for us to provide that clearinghouse and, you know, respect all the contracts and all the negotiation in terms of buying and selling data on that side. Provide delivery to clients via menu like we just described, and manage all the replication and placement and all these sorts of issues that we talk about in geo-distributed clouds today. And so I think, you know, it's a nice vision. It's a long, you know, it's a challenging vision, and it requires kind of integrating economics and system design, system architecture in the same way that that had to be done to turn computing from an infrastructure or from a commodity to a service. And so I think, you know, if you break down some of the challenges, you know, in a gross way, There's kind of the systems challenges around managing geodistributed analytics. Things like, once you've decided the providers and you've negotiated these contracts, how do you store the data? Where do you place it? How do you do query planning in a way that you're not moving the data around all the time to answer every query, and you're dealing with that? And you know, a lot of these relate to things that we've already addressed in CDNs and sustainable computing and geographic load balancing type applications. The complexity is that now you have to respect the data costs and the constraints placed by data access policies within these systems, which actually adds a whole new level of complexity to these sorts of algorithms and management. But I'm not going to talk about that today, because the more fundamental thing is, how do you talk about the market for data? And this is something that immediately when you start thinking about this problem, it's a really hard good to price. And the reason why it's such a hard good to price, it's really strange. If you think about it from an economic perspective, it's not like oil. And there's a lot of really fundamental differences about data compared to other goods that you have to address if you're going to start to build a market like this. And all of those startups and companies that I had on the previous slide are addressing these issues in different ways, and it's really not clear yet what the right way of handling these complexities is. So the first order one is, you know, zero marginal cost. Once you have data, took a lot of effort to get it, but once you have it, you can sell it as many times as you want with zero marginal cost. So this is what's called a digital good in economics, and it causes lots of problems, right? So if you think naively about this, as soon as you have two people with the same data, well, competition should drive the price to zero, right? Because everybody's willing to sell it for lower than the other. That doesn't lead to a very natural or efficient marketplace. So how do you deal with that? The typical way in economics is versioning. So if you think of, you know, selling MP3s or selling movies, you can buy the SD version, you can stream it, you can own it, you can buy the HD version, you can go see it in the theater. There's added value so that you have high quality and low quality versions of this. Something like that could make sense for data, but how do you go about doing this versioning, and is it necessary? Another very strange thing about data is the complementarities and the externalities. So if you think of data, the value of a piece of data depends on what else the customer knows, and who else knows that information, right? If I'm selling you a stock tip that the rest of the world knows about, it's not so valuable. If I'm selling you a stock tip that you're the only one that will know about, that's really interesting, right? And if you already know it, then it's not valuable. If you don't know it, then it could be very valuable. So there's a lot of externalities and complementarities that make it very hard to deal with this sort of data. And this motivates things like exclusivity contracts. Right, so how do you handle this? Well, who do you sell to? Maybe you're exclusive with some quality levels, but not exclusive with other quality levels. This feeds into the zero marginal cost quite a bit. It's very hard to value for both of these reasons, lead to value, but also it's just hard to value because there's so many different versions. If I have a data set, I could sell you marginals of it, I could sell you the mean of it, I could sell you the access to the whole thing, I could sell you queries. All of these are in some sense different goods that I have to value and price in different ways. And so how do you go about doing that? And this sort of means that if I'm going to try to write down a menu, if I'm off on the value of each piece of data by a little bit, I'm off on the value of the whole data set by a huge amount, so any error is really magnified. This is, you know, a natural push towards auctions or mechanisms in terms of developing these markets. And then there's the sort of resale fact. Once I give you the data, you're now my competitor, because you could just turn around and sell it to everybody else for slightly lower than I sold it to you because of the zero marginal cost. So how do you deal with resale? This is another big challenge. Is this valuable? Because maybe I can extract more from you if I give you the right to resell it later on. How do you deal with this? So resale restrictions. And then, of course, there's privacy. So leakage creates social ramifications. How does privacy build into these markets? And I could keep going down the list. There's more and more. But the point here is just to, you know, make it clear that this is a really strange economic good. Markets around it are really challenging. We don't have good tools to build these markets right now. I see a couple of economists that I wrangled into coming. I think they'd agree with that statement. As a result, when you look at data markets today, basically, the way they work is a bunch of salesmen get together in a room for weeks, hash out a contract that holds for months, and no one knows if they're getting a good deal or not. There's really strange negotiations that happen here. And Factual is one of the key startups in the area. This is how their contracts are born out. They do this with every client. They do this regularly. They try to update their contracts. But it's not a service the way we have computing today. And so I like, you know, an analogy here. It's very much like we're in the 90s for internet advertising. So in the 90s in internet advertising, this is exactly the way things worked. You had salesmen getting together in, you know, closed doors meetings to try to negotiate contracts for how to show ads on search engines or on websites or in magazines. And they had to work out these contracts on a long-term scale. It was very expensive to work out the contracts, no personalization, few ads. You know, you basically had few places you could show the ad. And, you know, what happened was we had these, you know, startups. Again, I have to do a plug for Caltech here. You know, both of this is the sort of Yahoo side of internet advertising. This is the Google side. They all came out of Caltech. And so they kind of changed the game. All of a sudden, you had these contracts for advertising being done online as search terms were entered into Google and Yahoo, priced via auctions real time. You had a whole new service. I mean, you had a marketplace there that was automated and fundamentally different from what was here. And this was, again, an interaction of the system architecture and the economics in terms of determining the market and determining the value. And I think there's a lot of parallels, not just in terms of the way things are today, but in terms of the hardness of valuing this. So when you think of ad slots for on the web, again, zero marginal cost. I could put as many there as I wanted without much impact. Strong externalities. If I'm putting one firm there, I'm preventing any other firm from being there. So this is creating negative value for them. It's really hard to value what is a search term on, you know, Google search for or a Bing search for Ford worth, right? I can't put a value on that to write down a menu. I have to depend on auctions. I have to depend on the bidders to sort of reveal their value for it. And so a lot of, you know, these three are exactly the things that I had on the previous slides about data. And, you know, to make the parallel, even the same people are running the startups in this space. So this applied semantics startup, which was the, you know, underlying Google, the ad auctions there, was run by Gil Albez, who's now leading the charge at Factual. And so the question, I guess, you know, and this is a question for all of us, not just the research, is can we make the same transition for data markets? You know, that took about 4 years in ad auctions to make that transition. And so if we're going to be the same, you know, 5 years from now or a decade from now, we should have this transition for data. And so clearly it's a hard problem. I don't have much to give you in terms of results. We have an initial systems paper. We have some new theory. So what I'm going to give you is a very concrete example where to show you how complex this can get and to show you that there's some counterintuitive results about how to design these markets. So the concrete case will be the place where data markets are most prominent today. The largest data market today is around internet advertising to get information on the slots being showed to people. And so if you think of, you know, what this looks like, you have your search engine, it has ad slots that it's trying to price and trying to fill with advertisers. Advertisers are bidding on these ad slots, but the advertisers don't know the value of the slot. And what determines the value of the slot is kind of the properties of the person, the properties of the eyeball seeing that slot. So, you know, if this is IKEA, they really care if you are trying to look for new furniture right now. And, you know, I'm looking for new furniture right now, so I looked at some websites, and now everybody, you know, every ad I see is from some furniture store, right, because they all know that I'm looking in. And how do they know that? They know that because they bought that piece of data from somebody who was monitoring my browsing, right? And so who owns that data right now? Well, you can imagine two things. It could be Bing or it could be some external provider. So the simple case is think of Bing, you know, having seen me looking at IKEA or knowing that I looked at IKEA. They could make a choice now to sell that data to the advertisers. How would they do that? And here, you know, they could sell it exclusively. They could pick one advertiser, have an auction, you know, sell it only to the one that bids the most. They could sell it to that one and allow that one to sell it to others if they want to. They could restrict resale. They could have different quality levels that they sell. They could sell one person, you know, that this is a, you know, 30-something male looking at furniture. The other one, they could say this is an adult who looked at furniture within the last month, within the last year. Lots of different versions. The sort of cool result here is that if you do this and the data provider is the one with the information, then you can maximize revenue as Bing by giving away the data for free and running a fairly sophisticated kind of auction called a Meyerson auction. And so in some sense here, you know, Bing doesn't have much incentive to run a data market. Bing should just give away the data, and if they give away the data and everybody's rationally bidding in this this mechanism, then they're going to maximize their revenue. Now, there's caveats here. This is a really, it's a cool result, but it's a really fragile result. It doesn't hold if you have second price auctions, which is the way ad auctions are really run. And more importantly, it doesn't hold if anybody else knows this data. So if there's some other cookie collector that knows that I was looking for furniture and they offer the data, well, then Bing loses out. And so the question becomes now, with this other external entity, I got you. 1 minute. So then how should the data cloud sell the data? And here we get back to these exclusivity versioning pricing. And so I'll give you three counterintuitive things. So exclusivity is a nice one. So should the data provider pick someone? How should they sell to one advertiser, or should they sell to everybody? The cool result here is that really the data provider doesn't need to worry about resale, because they can create a prisoner's dilemma. They can create a situation where I'm going to sell it to you, and you know that because he has the data, you're at such a disadvantage that now you really need to pay a lot of money to make sure that that disadvantage doesn't happen. And so they can create these sort of threat policies and get everybody to need to buy the data. And so they can really extract a lot of value that way. So that's, I think, a pretty cool result. And it avoids the need for resale and exclusivity. Versioning, the message here is that you can actually provide versioning in a very strong way. You can provide versioning using the tools that we've developed for privacy. So using differential privacy as a tool, you can provide different quality levels. And this has the really nice feature of then if you sell low quality data to multiple people, they can't combine it to get high quality data out. And it also means that you can go to the privacy literature and look at mechanisms for pricing and use those to sell the different version, the different quality levels in this context. And it gives you for free a way of, kind of the counterintuitive result saying that protecting privacy is not only valuable for the consumers, but it lets the company make more money off the data. And that's my last sentence. Thank you. I'll leave this out and I'll just stop there. Thanks.
All right, great.
Yeah.
So I'm not following the relationship between versioning and our zero marginal cost. Because it seems to me, if there was zero marginal cost of the data initially, the fact that there's five versions, there's still zero marginal cost of the copy. So what's going on there?
So yeah, so think of the movie. So now this, movies are a little bit imperfect because maybe you just pirate them. But if you think of buying a movie, there's kind of the low quality version that you could in some sense get from free by poking around online. There's a slightly more high quality version that you get. You get the legal value, you get to watch it in a more reliable way, or you can get the really high quality version where it's the same good you're buying, but you go to the movie theater, you see it on the huge screen, you see it with other people. It's the same good in some sense, but there's added value in some way. And that added value allows you to differentiate. And once you can differentiate, you can extract money because of people's utility over this added value. It's not there, right? But this added value allows you to extract money from the differences in people's utility. So the people with very low utilities for it will still always go for the cheap, but if they have a little extra utility for this added value, then they get to you can extract that as the marketer.
One quick question for me, incremental data.
Yeah.
So here's some version of the data, but you're accruing more data all the time, but it becomes more valuable because you already bought the old data.
Yeah, and I think that's a really good thing. So a lot of times...
Different from these other commodities.
Yeah, it's a very different commodity. And the other thing about this is a lot of people have this view that data is static, and once you buy it, you never need it again. Data is live update, right? And that's another thing that you can really extract in setting up these markets for data, because it's not as if you sell it and then they never need to come back to you. They need it to be updated and live.
Right. Yeah. Great. Thank you. One more thank you. Now we have Doug Berger.
So I don't think my clicker is working, so I'll just refer to this.
Use mine if you want.
Oh, I stole this.
Oh, so that's...
Is this yours?
Yeah, this is mine.
Okay.
You want to swap it? It's that one.
Oh, that'd be great. Thank you. Use the wrong clicker. There we go.
There you go.
Thank you very much. Okay, it's great to be here. I'm fortunate to be presenting this with some of my senior product group colleagues in the room, Kushagra and Mark Tremblay and Greg McKnight. And they've seen a bunch of this before, so I have to apologize to them in advance. And you guys can feel free to raise your hand and tell me where I'm off base. What's that? Of course. Expect nothing less. Okay, so I think we're all here to talk about cloud and cloud systems, and the cloud is super disruptive. And I wanted to spend a few minutes talking about why it's disruptive. This may be old hat to some of you. This may be not old hat to some of you. So I think broadly, I don't think people realize the pace at which the cloud is eating the server market. And so if you, I won't cite the exact numbers, but if you look at, you know, what fraction of servers now go into the big cloud providers, it's well more than double digits. I don't mean triple digits, I mean, you know, more than 10%, much more. And you look at the published growth rates of the cloud, and, you know, growing at double or triple digits. And so it's not, even though the overall server market is growing, it's not very long before you've eaten the whole thing, okay? And just a small number of years. And that is a huge economic disruptor. You know, some earlier this year, I was in DC at a, you know, national supercomputing panel, and I was talking to all the old DOE and DARPA folks that I used to work with when I was at UT, and they're all kind of the old, you know, supercomputers, national labs, ASCII, you know, vector machines, da-da-da. And I was saying, you know, the cloud is going to grow so large, we can do things, if things become economic that aren't possible in smaller deployments, even at the scale of you know, the national infrastructure. And they just really didn't understand it. You know, it's sort of like this has come up so fast, people don't see how the economics are going to shift. And so I think it's pretty clear to me that eventually the cloud will eat the HPC market, except for maybe some very, very tail niche cases. And so, you know, and so you're going to see a lot of industrial disruption over the next few years because there's a lot of companies out there doing this sort of stuff, and it's consolidating incredibly fast. So that's one thing that I think is really important to understand. And it's happening even faster than hardware design cycles. Okay. And so what that means for the big providers, once you're running at a certain scale, you know, you'll increase the amount of first-party hardware development that you do. Okay, it doesn't mean that you necessarily go all the way, but I think, and I won't cite a lot of examples, but you all know of examples where some of the big providers have started building their own this or their own that. And the reason is, you know, once you're at a certain scale, you multiply your scale times the profit margin of that component, and if that's much greater than the NRE to produce that component, it makes sense to build it yourself. Like you need to build the capacity, but then you get to put in your own features. Okay, and then you get to upgrade, and you're in control of your own destiny, and you don't have to rely on small numbers of suppliers. So I think as it's just an inevitable fact, I'm not speaking for Microsoft per se, that as the cloud providers grow larger and as the market consolidates, it becomes economic for them to do more and more stuff in-house, which also fundamentally changes, you know, the relationships and the ecosystem of the component providers. Some of them go away. Some of them have a much smaller number of customers. You know, some of them can afford to bifurcate their products into a small number of versions. Okay. And the interesting thing is if you look across, you know, we were talking, Kushagra and I and others were talking at lunch, if you look across the big cloud vendors, they all have a different combination of strengths and architectural approaches and capabilities, and they're strong in this part of the market and weaker in this part of the market. And so it's not like they're all converging on the same design. I wouldn't say they're diverging rapidly, but there is some divergence. And so it's really interesting. There's some big experiments being run right now that I don't think people have their heads around. There's a huge tension between cost and features. So for the public cloud, if you can offer a significantly larger number of virtual machines per dollar than your major competitors, you can sell with healthy profit margins at something that at a price that they lose money at massive scale. Right? So in some sense, there's this really big kind of scary, if you're one of these big companies, war going on where you've got to keep your costs very low because you can't afford to let your competitors come in and undercut you if they're much better at controlling costs. And everyone's in a race to offer denser VMs per dollar. And you know, the winners will be the ones that can do that the best. But then you also need to differentiate and add features, you know, whether it's better networks or different appliances or different support for different verticals or different degrees of security and isolation or reliability, you know, or global scale or, you know, availability in this region for national boundary laws for the handling of data or geo-replication. You know, all of these things, you know, factor in. And so there's this huge tension right now between the features you offer to differentiate and controlling those costs, because this is really an economic, at the end of the game, it's an economic war. Okay, and I think, you know, many of you who remember the 90s and think back to that era, remember that when the microprocessor started to come up very fast and we went on this, you know, decade-long frequency binge, you know, which was kind of a, you know, the memory wall era where everyone thought it would, you know, increase forever, and then it didn't. You know, exponentials tend to do that. I mean, stop. But the processor and what happened in the microprocessors and the scale of investment that the horizontal providers were able to make and optimizing performance was very disruptive to a lot of companies that were building these custom supercomputers, these multiprocessor machines. They just couldn't keep up, right? Because there was so much more money being put into the components, they were moving so fast. You know, by the time you got your system out, did the software work, you were years behind, and that economic improvement really just killed you. And I think, you know, we all work on patterns. That's a pattern that's in my head right now. And I think it's very similar to that era, not maybe in the particulars, but in the speed at which this transition is happening and the economic repercussions it's going to have. And, you know, we can maybe offline, we can speculate on what some of those might be. Okay. And then, so lots of people, you know, I'm a hardware architect, and, you know, lots of people work in computer architecture. When you're building accelerators, it's a hot area in the field right now. But so what should the acceleration architecture for this cloud be, Because you want to be more efficient than software in many cases, and all these things are happening, right? We have big scale, you know, it's an economic race, you've got to offer features, you know. So these are some of the problems that my team took on, and we've been working very closely with Kushagra's team, and I talked to Mark a lot, and Greg and I were working together years ago. So, you know, what are the different approaches you might take? And so for this audience, I thought it might be useful to differentiate between spatial and temporal computing from a processing perspective, where, you know, I think of temporal computing as being what CPUs do, right? You know, you're streaming instructions or operations, you know, basically a time-based sequence through a fixed, piece of logic or silicon, which is a processor. You know, and so the CPUs are actually optimized. Of course, you want instruction cache hits for loops and locality, but really they're optimized to run large volumes of code. And they keep a small amount of state handy to operate on those. And they don't operate very well when you're working on large data sets, you know, because you take lots of cache misses, you go out to memory. And so if you look at the amount of code that's been written for the cloud, you know, it's enormous. Millions and millions of businesses in Azure, right, hundreds and hundreds of first-party properties that are collections of very large collaborating services within one property like Bing or Exchange. And just the amount, the volume of code that's being run temporally is huge. Now, spatial computing, you know, I certainly didn't define the term. It's been used for decades. It is this notion where rather than, you know, moving the code through, you fix the code and you run data through. So I think of these really as orthogonal things. Right, where you're transposing what's really the bulk of what's moving, okay. And there's lots of ways to do, lots of architectures to do spatial computing, but typically the hardware functions are fixed. And there's been a pretty interesting convergence between the two in some research projects, you know, like triggered instructions and whatnot. But the bet we took for spatial computing more recently is FPGAs. And I heard someone told me earlier that Satya this morning said that we had a large deployment at the fireside chat, which I missed. Okay, so I guess I can say for me to say here.
That was 2 days ago.
Was it 2 days ago? All right.
I'm catching up.
I'm catching up. All right. Okay. What's that?
You better sleep more.
You mean I wasn't sleeping when he was talking? I wasn't there and sleeping, believe me. Okay. So we've deployed a very large collection of FPGAs, and you know, I wouldn't say that's exclusive because you can also do ASICs to support streaming or other types of accelerators. So I wouldn't say that this is the only bet we're making. It's just one of the large bets that we've made. Okay, so I thought what I'd talk a little bit, because this will be, you know, some of this is public and more of it will be public soon, kind of the architecture that we've produced to do spatial computing. And I got my slides in the wrong order here. I must have hit the button by mistake. I'm missing a slide. Okay, well, anyways. So what we've deployed is this kind of bump in a wire configuration that Azure's talked about, and they're using it for network and storage and crypto acceleration. And so what we do is we take, we call this internally the Catapult V2 architecture. We take it's very different from what we published in 2014. You've got a server and the NIC, and then your FPGA, which is one of our spatial accelerators, and this is one that's been deployed at large scale already. And the FPGAs talk directly to the switch hierarchy. So in some sense, your network traffic is streaming through this. So it really supports a streaming model for infrastructure, a spatial model for infrastructure. You can put fixed functions there, and then the traffic streams through. We also have a connection, which I don't show here, to the host, so you can use it for applications. You know, you can fix a function there and then send data across and stream that through and get the results back. Okay? But if you're going to put an architecture like this at scale in the cloud, what you actually want is the ability to build larger streaming configurations than just what one FPGA might provide, especially if you need to allocate some of the FPGA area, you know, to at least processing the network traffic. Okay? And so one of the neat things about this architecture is that the FPGAs can talk directly to one another through the switch hierarchy without needing any software intervention. Okay? And so this is not how we're using it universally, but this is one way you can use it for application acceleration. And so then what you can do is have the FPGAs encapsulate IP packets, send them through the switch hierarchy, and it turns out this is very low latency. You know, one-way transmission through the switch through a local switch is 1.5 microseconds, and then that goes up to sub-10 if you go through the top-level spine, which gives you actually a diameter of hundreds of thousands of servers within a data center, you know, in under 10 microseconds. And so that diameter is very large and allows you, in theory, to do a massive amount of streaming computation, you know, streaming acceleration by pumping data streams through. And you can do that by daisy chaining them, you can build trees, you can build graphs, or you can just do map-reduced like parallel structures where you deploy something, you stream it in locally from the local disks. Okay, so how do you manage something like this? Well, first, I thought I'd show you why this is useful for the cloud, you know, with some production results. So this is the first thing that we launched into production, which was Bing ranking acceleration, and this is slightly different functions than what we published, but these are actual production results. And I don't have the labels here for confidentiality reasons, but you have load here on the x-axis, so queries per second, you know, throughput, and then latency on the y-axis. And people talk about tail latency, you know, and how you bring that in. One of the nice things about spatial computing is once you fix the function, it's pretty predictable. You know, you might have a longer document that you need to stream through, and that will take some extra time, but you don't have to worry about cache misses and a lot of threads colliding. So you tend to get more stable results. It's a lot of work to build the function and get it out and deploy it, but once you have it, it's more predictable, and you kind of can get a handle on what the latency should be. And so sure enough, when we put a bunch of the Bing ranking backend into this sort of spatial computing, you know, the dots in blue I'm showing are the FPGA accelerated ranking traffic. You know, this is customer facing traffic in one data center with FPGAs, and then the orange dots are a different data center running pure software, but the same, you know, the same functions. And these are actually the 99.9% tail results already. So these are the slow results. And what you can see is there's just a lot of jitter, you know, due to, you know, a server gets overloaded, you know, the CPUs are missing in the cache, there's collision, something else, some other service starts running up. But here we have a very, very stable run, and we can go up to about double the throughput, and we're still faster than the fastest software query. So but operating that tight band is really compelling. And so when you have a streaming amenable application that you can apply to spatial computing or spatial acceleration, it works very well. Now, you can't do this for everything. And then there's another graph that I don't have time to show you. But it's basically the same data. You can see the software jitter here. So this is over a 5-day period. Blue is software jitter, and then the green shows, you know, the same results for FPGAs over a 5-day period. And the green numbers are running at about double the load as the blue numbers. I'm sorry? It's a linear scale. Yep. So about 25% latency improvement, which kind of matches what you see here. Yep. I'm sorry. I should at least put normalized scale on the number. Okay. So I think just to summarize, these sort of spatial accelerations are a good way to think about, you know, the other set type of computing, and we're very good at temporal because we have lots of CPUs deployed, and then I think the cloud, because of this feature competition, will all eventually support spatial acceleration or spatial computing as a second paradigm. And then just the question is, you know, what are the types of accelerators? What workloads do we do? What does the platform look like? How do you build larger spatial streaming fabrics embedded in the cloud? And this is our approach to do it. I'm sure our competitors are doing great stuff too. Thank you. Well, sure. So the question was, can I comment on how we program this fabric? And just so everyone else could hear, and there's a lot of people working on this now, many in the product group, so I don't want to answer for everybody. I will say that my team in general uses Verilog and hand codes it. And that's, you know, you could say that's expensive, but it turns out if you're operating at large enough scale, hiring a Verilog team to implement some of these functions becomes very economic. And then we are, you know, using, always looking at OpenCL and A++, also from Intel Altera and other things. And, you know, those tool chains are getting better and better, and there are some instances where they work okay. Over the time, I think they'll get better, and they will eventually be using them heavily. But they're not quite there yet for universal use.
Okay. So
can Jason ask one question, even though
I
tried to keep you on time?
Thanks. So, you know, this...
A short question.
Yeah, so...
I appreciate it. That's not a question, though.
No, really. I'm a huge fan. But, you know, these ideas have been out for a little bit. Right? And
which ideas? That's not a short question. Sorry.
The FPGA cloud.
Okay.
The ways of integrating. I'm curious as to your thoughts as to why we're not seeing other companies follow suit or other entities with the capability of building these systems start to
Okay, I'll say that's a great question. The question was, are you guys wrong because you're the only ones doing this? Okay, if I paraphrase it.
That's a quick question. Okay.
And I won't comment on anything I know about what our competitors are doing. Okay, I'll say three things. Number one, it's easier to play catch up once you know that something is de-risked, especially if that thing is new and risky. Okay, so, you know, we know some things our competitors are doing, and I think, you know, if they pan out, work really well, we may have to play catch up, and I would hope the shoe's on the other foot as well. Okay. Number two, I think that you saw Intel's recent acquisition of Altera, and you see a lot of industry alliances and consortia forming. So I don't think it's fair to say that we are isolated in our belief that this is a important technology. I think no one else has announced a scale deployment yet, you know, but Xilinx has formed a consortium with everybody else. Intel has acquired Altera. Okay. You know, there is, I mean, everyone else other than Intel. Okay, so there's a lot of industry moves happening that I can promise you are not exclusively driven by Microsoft's deployment. Okay, and the third thing is I think we just don't know how far this will go. It's working really well for some stuff. Does it become a critical thing, or is this sort of an interesting project that helped, you know, Azure networking and Bing and a few other things? And I think that is TBD.
Okay, this one's for Doug. So we've been discussing a little bit about the change, at least the way we saw it when we read the Catapult paper was that the network card and the FPGA would be fully integrated, and it would basically be integrated with the host system and the cache coherence protocol and so forth. Now it seems there's this change that you move the FPGA out into the wire, it's a bump in the wire, which kind of reduces, to me, the utility of these FPGAs because I can't integrate as easily with the software that might be running on my host, just due to latency going through the wire. So I was wondering why that apparent change, and also maybe a little bit further, the shorter question is, what kinds of things are you currently offloading, if you can say?
So okay, two-part question. Number one, I don't think it's actually more restricted. I think it's more general. Except that you have to pay, in every case, the tax of running the network traffic through the FPGA. So I didn't show in the picture. There's also a PCIe connection to the host CPU, which is what we used in the original deployment. And you can actually get from FPGA to FPGA in the network about as fast as we could through the original Taurus. So you don't need to pay for a second network, which has all sorts of deployment constraints. Kushagra, I think, can probably speak to those too, since we deployed a lot in the pilot, and they were his, you know, his team servers holding the FPGA and having the network attached. But you can still go multi-FPGA. You can still go locally. You know, you can still now process the network traffic. So I think it's strictly more general than the previous design, which is why we went to it. And it makes sense that this design, this architecture, makes sense to deploy at scale economically, economic sense the last one didn't. Okay, what sort of workloads we're doing? I think Azure has publicly said that they're doing software-defined network, SDN, offload. And they've publicly said they're doing crypto. And then we've publicly said we're doing Bing.
Today.
OK.
I had a question for Doug as well. So I was wondering if you could comment on, as Catapult is being deployed through Microsoft, what is the kind of life cycle of a FPGA cloud application? Do people kind of optimize that bottleneck and then, move on to a new bottleneck because you've optimized it away? Or, what's the kind of distribution of applications that seem to change a lot versus once you're done with them, you kind of move on to new hotspots?
It's a great question. So I won't speak for Azure because I think they've got their functions and, they're working on features. I just want to leave, what they've said public. For our application work with some of the first-party services that we run, you'll find a bottleneck, you'll rewrite it in Verilog, you'll deploy it, and then as your stack changes, you might replace that function with something that's now more expensive. Maybe that will get deprecated, and that's happened actually a couple times. So we're getting we're building a bag of functions, and then one has actually been deprecated, and then we're reliving it. So we're just getting a bigger toolbox, and then sometimes those functions stay resident, and then you deploy new ones on other FPGAs, across the network as a complement. And so we actually have an architecture to do that, and we'll be talking more about that in an upcoming paper.
Hi, this is a question for Adam. It's a fascinating talk. So I have the following question. When you give an example, you argue that this is similar like the ad market, like it was, 20 years ago. However, there is one difference. In the case of the ad market, there was a very big market out there, traditional market. So for better or worse, there was some, clear value for different ways to do the ads. And again, the first step of going online or banner ads. In the case of the data, do you have an example of a market today for the data?
Yeah, I think that's a great point. So the offline ad marketplace was much more mature than the offline data marketplace is today. That said, data is being bought and sold quite a bit, and the growth rate for this is pretty incredible. The one I'd point to right now is probably around advertising, so that's why we chose that example for the last slide. So there, this is still online, and it's through ad exchanges, and that's, I'm going to blow the number, but it's a bigger industry right now than the airline industry in terms of the data exchange around online advertising. But that's one specific vertical, and I think the question is how you transition to other verticals like healthcare or location-based and these sorts of things, and it's a big question. So I think there's a good question of whether it's the market is as ripe as advertising was when that happened.
Okay, you're last then. Sorry.
So you can think of the credit score companies as a huge data market. The credit score companies? The credit score, Equifax, TransUnion.
There are some markets, that have an ear thing about London.
Yeah.
But for those, the challenge is to assign value to the data. When you have the end-to-end application, you know exactly for what you are going to use the data, there is quite a bit of, you know the value. That's only the other financial. But in general, the value depends so much about what you are going to do to the data that the value is
No, I think that's a really good point. And I'm even in online advertising, you see a range of about 1,000 in terms of the differentiation across different verticals in terms of what people will pay for it. And there's a huge differentiation in the verticals. And I would expect this market to grow across verticals rather than be universal starting point.
Very interesting talk from all three of you. Thank you very much. Thanks. Now we have Douglas Carmin from Microsoft.
Thanks, Kathryn. So I thought, of course, I wanted to talk about something that I've been working on. And I thought there would be a lot of these talks that started with Moore's Law and the Moore's Law and stuff like that. So that was the motivation for the title of the talk. But I realized as I was putting this together and also sitting listening to it, it seems more appropriate that that what I really wanted to talk about is like the cloud really seems like it's becoming an architecture playground, and I'll hit on that as the endpoint. But there's this having spent 25 years at Intel, suffering under very poor conditions of being able to innovate. The did I say that? Wait, I didn't really say that. So maybe a more positive way of saying that is that it's like refreshing to have the cloud as a way that we can introduce new architectures without thinking about both legacy and like the implications of what the architecture is. And I'll hit that at the last point. But I had to start with Moore's law. And the dates to the side here are like an internal bet that Mark and I made a handful of months ago. So as you know, I'm sorry.
What did you bet?
Yeah, it's a secret. So I apologize for embarrassing Mark, because this was kind of a private thing that was going back and forth. But the interesting thing, I think, is like even some of the most optimistic views are starting to say that you can start putting dates that are near term for Moore's law. So that was really my motivation for coming to Microsoft and working on these things, of which I've had the real fun luxury of working on three projects. And I'll talk about the first two, which are quantum computing. And in the 2 years that I've been working on quantum computing, I think that the horizon for a universal quantum computing actually coming in our lifetime has shrunk by about 10 years. We'll be a little bit more open about that, I think, in the coming years. Cryogenic computing came about as a way of controlling the quantum computer. And I think that this is a really important ingredient and part of the reason that I think we're going to be successful actually building up this building up the quantum computer. And then finally, the DNA storage came about as asking the question, if you start to solve computing, what do you do about storage? And while DNA storage has real issues with read and write times, I think those issues are kind of traceable back to fundamental technology that can be addressed even using silicon technology and following Moore's law. So that's another talk, but there's promise there. This is today, if you had to produce a picture of what a quantum computer looks like, that's the most advanced dilution refrigerator that we've placed an order for. The cool thing about that is that all of those connectors that's just 120 wires that connect a quantum computer to the room temperature. So one of the fundamental problems with dealing with a quantum computer is that the interface to the quantum computer is extremely limited. We came up with this idea of using a cryogenic computer or something that's running at 4 degrees Kelvin as a way of doing tight control with that quantum machine. So it really means that deployment of a quantum computer in the cloud also will deploy a cryogenic computer, and that has some really interesting characteristics that I'll talk about. The fun thing about working on these is that they've given me the ability to think about each aspect of computing from kind of a different angle. Quantum computing really is about manipulating these subatomic particles. So the easiest qubit to talk about is a spin qubit, where you're actually controlling the spin of individual electrons to do the computing. So it's no longer talking about nanometers or what's your gate size or do you have high K dielectric or not. The fun thing about quantum computing is actually manipulating the subatomic particles and actually doing computing there. Cryogenic computing, because of the closeness to quantum, is really near the Landau limits of noise, really close to KT log 2. And that's interesting because like all of the noise limitations, all of the margins are so close to the fundamental noise floor that it makes all of the calculations right at the theoretical limits of what we think is possible. And finally, DNA storage is all about manipulating biological components. I guess the part of the reason for talking about it like this is that the thinking about Moore's law, and as we've been pushing the fundamentals of CMOS lithography up to 14 nanometers, 7 nanometers, thinking about can we actually do lithography at 3 nanometers, if you pop beyond that, you can really start thinking about doing manipulations of material right down at the what we understand to be the fundamental physics level. So some of the early lessons, it's different than CMOS. You have to rethink some of the laws. All of the aspects that we've been looking at in terms of power, performance, and even area have at least two orders of magnitude of benefit relative to CMOS. And that starts to open up some really interesting possibilities. And this observation of like manipulating objects at the fundamental level of molecular manipulation, of electron manipulation, of things at the absolute noise floor, bring about new ways of thinking about computation as well as how they get deployed. One quick example, I pulled a slide from Bill Daly, some of the HPC work that he was doing at NVIDIA. This is just like, what is the energy associated with doing a double precision 64-bit double precision function. He attributes, well, the energy associated with the actual operation is 20 picojoules, but if you have to actually move the data to the ALU, you consume significantly more energy. The cryogenic opportunity here is that all of those wire costs go to zero. So, of course, I have to add back in what the refrigeration costs are. But the really interesting thing about the way that we have to think differently about the way this machine is put together is that when we're building computer architectures the way that we have been traditionally, which Daly's right here, you have to these days really think hard about the communication costs. If the cryogenic thing really works, it's now turns that equation on its head, where really this several orders of magnitude higher cost of energy in communication now is essentially zero. I put this together to try and talk about the high-level trade-offs that might happen as you look at classical at room temperature, a cryogenic machine, and a quantum computer. I didn't really go through any of the details here, but it's super interesting if you look at the possibilities of what happens at compute. You know, we routinely talk about applications that will work well on a quantum machine can show 10 to the ninth or a billion orders of billions types of acceleration in terms of performance, again, for applications that work well on quantum. But then they have these really bad trade-offs in terms of bandwidth and memory capacity. The memory doesn't really work with quantum. So what do the trade-offs look like for that machine? Then the other interesting thing is, like we talked about, the compute versus bandwidth trade-offs also at cryogenic are fundamentally different. So how does this affect the cloud? Well, it's interesting. Coming from Intel, it was a really fun place to participate because, like, as Doug talked about it, is that we would build these server machines. They're getting deployed in the cloud. You turn to people like Google, Amazon, and Microsoft, and they were just buying CPUs, deploying them in the cloud. It looked very homogeneous. Today, we know that there are FPGAs. There are lots of GPUs. Michael Taylor showed a nice picture of these Bitcoin servers. And you see something that's starting to be very heterogeneous. My contention is that tomorrow, we'll still have these FPGAs. I believe that we'll be deploying quantum machines and cryo machines in the cloud. They're not necessarily going to displace FPGAs, and the advent of ASICs where specific functions have been cast into FPGAs and show good utility will wind up having their place. But the cloud, I think, becomes this very heterogeneous place where we can deploy architectures that show good benefit. You know, much to my surprise when I go and talk to our cloud guys and say, I want to put a DNA hard drive in the cloud. It's not like, get out of my office. It's more of like, they want to know what the read and write bandwidths are. So it's like the possibilities and potential of this being a good place for actually doing deployment of interesting architectural ingredients that have clear benefit is much more significant than I've ever seen it before in my career. I also thought that it was kind of interesting as I thought about this talk of like what's happened here, because like I enjoyed these early 90s through the early 2000s working at Intel, the other half of Wintel, where there was this huge consolidations of architectures, and you just remember these names of Alpha, MIPS, PA Risk, 88K, Spark, Itanium, and do I need to go on? Of like, they're just like littered the halls of the museums these days. They didn't survive. What survived was a scalable architecture, this major consolidation. But I think what we're seeing coming out of the end of that is one more huge fragmentation that gives us this opportunity for doing lots and lots of architecture exploration. It's like one of the funnest times, I think, to be alive as a computer architect. And you know, I didn't really know how to label this explosion that came out of the ENIAC in the early 60s, where there was just like this massive proliferation of the first wave of computers. But I think what we're seeing here is this massive proliferation again of architectures that will come kind of out of this third wave of computing. And that's where I'll wrap up. Thank you.
Doug is the first speaker to not have the stop sign go off. So, questions?
Always a pleasure. So you alluded to this, but you didn't say anything. Refrigeration versus like compute power costs, right? Break-even point?
Right. So it all depends on the temperature. And it's really, I showed you that dilution fridge that has kind of like big gold discs. And there are a couple interesting points in there. Is like 77K is the boiling point of nitrogen, so it's 10 to 1 cooling cost versus input power. So said another way, for every watt that you have at 77K, it costs 10 watts to cool it. When I talk about the cryo computer, I'm talking about it at liquid helium levels at 4K, and the current rough state of the art is about 200 to 1. So for every watt of power that I consume at 4K, I have to put 200 watts in.
That's in that wind based on the numbers you showed, but
if you look at the device levels, what I tried to do is actually show you the numbers including refrigeration on the quick DALI slide that I showed. So if you do the per device, you get about four orders of magnitude of regular CMOS versus a Josephson junction device. So it's four orders of magnitude. You take off two orders of magnitude for refrigeration. The theoretical number says that there's an opportunity of about another two orders of magnitude of realized energy savings. And at this point of a project where you're still doing early research or advanced development, I'm not saying I'm going to deliver two orders of magnitude. I'm just saying, I'll deliver a substantial benefit of which I can see I've got two orders of magnitude sitting in front of me.
And one more question. Since you finished early, you get two.
Give me a slide. What does the heterogeneity do to your reliability and maintenance of your people who actually do that? So while you allude to the very homogeneous system that Google and others deploy, they also tried these FPGA-type acceleration. But one of the reasons I understand they gave up is essentially the people who maintain it and make sure availability and reliability is doing. So can you actually comment on what it really does to your production people and who do these maintenance once you start having all these heterogeneity that you're speaking of?
Yeah, I think it gets into like an interesting breakdown of like what are the most unreliable things in a data center. And this is a place I can talk naively and not really put the other Microsoft spot guys on the spot. But my understanding is that the biggest points of unreliability that we have are things like the power supplies and things like the disk drives themselves. So we have to have a solution for that. I think the problem that we have with massive explosions of heterogeneity in the cloud is going to be an issue, but that is something that we have to work on. You know, what does maintenance look like? You know,
yeah,
can
I'm even asking about very simple operation stuff. So I want to know some of your operational folks getting insight before you come. So they basically say software upgrades, driver upgrades. So when you have things like FPGAs working with driver upgrades, you know, the interfaces, things break. So those type of challenges. So
we'll have to work on them. I don't have a good answer for that one.
Hi, glad to be here, and thanks for those of you who sticking around. So actually, I'm feeling a little bit conflicted here, so I'm coming after this very inspirational talk, talking about what is out there in 15, 20 years. So I'm going to talk about something, a more limited horizon, and I'm coming from academia, so it's a little bit of inconsistency here. Academia was supposed to go and look farther ahead. So, with this being said, you know, the title of the talk was Real-Time Intelligent and Secure System for Automated Decision Making. And after listening through some of the talks in the morning, I took the liberty to change a little bit. And, okay, so I'm going to talk about some trends and challenges in the big data. In particular, I'm going to focus on a few things. What are the application trends and what are our hardware trends? And what are the challenges and techniques which derives from these trends? And actually to, you know, why would you listen to me and to get a little more credibility, let me go back and say what one of the lessons we learned was a successful lesson. That's why I'm telling you about it. And this was in 2009. It was in the AM lab. And when you're starting research, actually we started doing research in 2006, pretty early. But in 2009, still, you know, the state of the art in the big data was MapReduce. It was a large scale, as everyone knows, very flexible data processing engine, fault tolerant, providing batch computation. So this means that the time of, you know, the response times of the computation times for the job, it was between tens of minutes and hours. So now let me go and you know, frame what was there in terms of the trends, first application trends. So you're already starting to see then that a few trends. One, it was interactive computations, the need for interactive computation. People have all these huge data. They are doing these batch computations, you know, compute web indexes and things like that. But then soon as they started to want to do some ad hoc analytics on this data. And clearly Hadoop was not that great for it. The other thing, actually, this was we saw in our lab, the machine learning people, back then, they were trying to scale their machine learning algorithms. And, of course, when they ask us, the system people say, oh, of course, use Hadoop. It didn't work that well for the reasons all of you know, because every iteration in the machine learning algorithms, it was basically translated into a job, MapReduce job, so it was very slow. But the other one was also is that we were lucky to have early access to some of the logs from Microsoft and also Facebook, their data clusters then. And we noticed that despite the huge amounts of data they store in the clusters, many working sets in those workloads are fitting in memory. And this is an example. This is basically saying that the input of 96% of the jobs are fitting in memory. It's Facebook and very similar at Microsoft. So what was the lesson there and what was the conclusion? About the hardware trends. Even then, the hardware trends, you know, the Moore's law was not as fast, at least for the CPUs. And the memory capacity was growing faster, and the SSD was or as a horizon. This was 7 years ago, right? So putting this all together, and we started to build Apache Spark, then it was kind of obvious we focused on in-memory processing, right? So we built a system to be optimized for in-memory processing, providing memory resilience, sharing data between different stages via memory, and so forth, okay? So, you know, that's kind of a lesson and an example. It does work well for us. So what about now? Okay, so what are the application trends? So I think the application trends, you know, if I were to summarize, is that people have today a lot of data. And they gather this data because they want to get some value out of the data. You know, we discussed earlier, that's kind of hard to quantify. But if you ask more and more people, will say that this value means for them to data to enable them to make decisions, take actions. Okay? And if you buy that premise, then what do you need, you know? Well, in general, faster decisions are better than slower decisions. So you want to make fast decisions. Decisions on fresh data, better than on the stale data. And decisions on personal data are in general better than on aggregate data, right? Everyone wants to do personalization. So what do you need in order to achieve that? Well, you need to provide real-time decisions on live data with strong security. Real-time, meaning, you know, I'm talking in terms of milliseconds, you know, decision, this should be the latency. Live data is the current state of the environment. I'm going to quantify a little bit how fast and what does it mean, live data, in the next slide. And security, you are talking about privacy, confidentiality, and integrity. You are talking about privacy because if I ensure you the privacy of the data, you are willing to maybe share with me some of the personalized data, right, if I maintain it private, and I guarantee you this. Integrity, well, we know and we are here that more and more of these algorithms are going to be run in the clouds. So if you run them in the clouds, then the need for data and computation integrity follows. So you look at a lot of these examples. Many of them you hear, you know, like zero-time defense, IoT, actually chip manufacturing, fraud detection, fleet driving, virtual assistants, and many, many more. And we have here, you know, something in terms of sophistication of the decisions and latency. So the latency there is a decision is referring to how fast the real-time decision should be. And the update is that how fresh the data on which I'm making the decision should be. And the lower bound there, at least for these examples, the first one should be in millisecond, one down, okay? So for decision latency is milliseconds, and for updates it's seconds, okay? Just to give you a sense. Okay, so you want to, at least for some application, to make milliseconds in decision with millisecond latency with on data which is seconds old. Okay, so what about hardware trends? You heard a lot this, and I'm sorry I'm repeating. Moore's law is slowing down, it's dead in 2020. And you hear that a lot, right? And now it's also in all the popular press, Economist, Nature, and so forth. So what does it mean? Again, you heard a lot. So this means the following, actually. The slowing down of the Moore's law, it affects differently different components. The CPUs, I believe, are the most affected. And for a long time, it was like for the past few years, the improvements are only 15-20% a year. And I think that's, you know, talking with some people actually from Intel, that is, they are more complex layouts. They are more complex, right? And harder to scale. And then when you are going to scale to improve the performance by parallelism, then you are going to have to deal with parallel programming, which we know is not easy sometimes. Memory still grows, or is still growing 30-40% per year. They are more easy, regular layouts. They can be stacked. And they have these 3D technologies and so forth. And the network also grows 30 to 50% a year. Actually, as a horizon, we have now gigabits per second Ethernet NICs at 100, 200, and 400 gigabits per second. Sorry. And you have also, including at Microsoft, you have full bisection bandwidth architecture network topologies. So if you look at all of these, the CPU is becoming the bottleneck, and these things are getting worse, right? And actually, the amount of RAM and the amount of capacity, memory capacity you have on a core, it's increasing. And you can see this also if you just look around. This is from AWS, right? It used to be that for their memory-intensive instances, you would have like between 6, 7, and 8 gigabytes per core, for virtual core, right? Where is their virtual core, right? Which is a hyperthread. If you look today, they announce, you know, they have X1, They have 17 gigabytes per virtual core. It's 2 terabytes machine with 120 core. Okay. So all of this Moore's law, like again you heard, it's triggering or pushing unprecedented hardware innovation. The talk before me was a great example in that sense. And you hear about, you know, going from CPU to specialized chips, GPUs, FPGAs, ASICs, coprocessors, you know, like tensor processing unit, tensor flow processing unit, and so forth. And also, they are more and more integrated. The latest Xeon is going to integrate CPU and FPGA and so forth. Then you have new memory technologies like high bandwidth memory and 3D crosspoint coming from Intel and Micron. So all in all, it's a renaissance of hardware design. So it's very, you know, this is what David Patterson, you know, his quote. But it's very exciting times. So now let me talk about these challenges and techniques, right? So first about some challenges of these strengths. So I think there's a key challenge we are confronting today. It's actually complexity. And the complexity is on different dimensions, computation or software development. It used to be that you write the software for the CPU, right? Now you write it for the CPU, but then you may have to write it for GPUs, FPGAs, ASICs, and by the way, if you're on security, now you have SGX or this kind of hardware enclaves on the processor. Then it's in terms of memory, right? This was used to be the memory hierarchy. You have L1, L2 cache, 1 nanosecond latency, L3 cache, 10 nanoseconds, main memory, 60 nanoseconds, and up to 100 nanoseconds. You know, you have 4 channels, 80 gigabytes per second, bandwidth, and, you know, hundreds of gigabytes of RAM. SSDs, 100 microseconds latencies, 10 gigabytes per second, depends how many lines of PCI Express you are going to use. One line is 2 gigabytes per second. You have what, terabytes of SSDs on a server, and then you have, of course, you know, hard disk drives. Okay. What you have now is at least this kind of complexity you have. You have high bandwidth memory, which is between now L3 cache and main memory, which is stacked on the chip. And you get to tens of nanoseconds, you know, something between the L3 cache and main memory. You can have, you know, up to 1 terabyte per second, more precisely 720 gigabytes is HBM2. And you have tens of gigabytes. You have main memory, and then you have this kind of non-volatile memories, a new generation, like 3D crosspoints, which you have microseconds, sub-microseconds, but if you believe you know it's what Intel is saying or what they are saying, the bandwidth is again. It's they are using PCI Express, but there is no fundamental limitation to not use wider and faster buses, and you can't you know it's like has much better density. It's like is claimed to have 9 times more capacity you can have in 3D crosspoint than in a DRAM. Okay? And then you have complexity, you know, you go to the Microsoft Azure, right? And if you look at the instances, this is what you are going to find, right? Tens, I think there are over 50 now. And of course, things are not much easier for Amazon and Google Cloud, right? Which one you are going to use? And we just heard we are going to have FPGAs and so forth, just multiplying this. Okay? And then, to make the problem even more interesting, you start to have constraints, more constraints. You are talking about latency, you are talking about computation accuracy, you are talking about machine learning, right? It's like how accurate is the translation? Of course, cost matters, you know, we heard that, and security. So now, let me go a little bit about the techniques. So what you are going to do here, and I think that there is no silver bullet, unfortunately, but I'm going to suggest a few techniques here. And I think that the first techniques I think is that let's think about, you have so many choices. Instead of thinking about how you are going to write your software now instead of covering and handling five levels of storage, how you are going to use these new storage options we have to simplify it. Maybe you can eliminate some of them, right? Expose control and control the trade-offs. It's always when you have these trade-offs, you better expose them and you allow the application or the user to control them. And don't forget try and true techniques. I'm always amazed about, you know, when we try to improve the performance or whatever, you go back to the same techniques. Nothing new under the sun, or very little. So here are some examples about using choice to simplify. I'll have two more minutes. This is NVIDIA DGX computer for deep learning. Okay, this is how it looks like. They have up to eight NVIDIA chips, and they are on HBM, on high bandwidth memory, and they are linked by this NVLink. It's a new technology. But then in addition to this storage, which is per chip, they have only persistent disaggregated storage, which is NAND SSDs, just a bunch of SSDs. Here is another possible data center architecture in which you are going to have each CPU, which is memories, and of course caches, which comes on the chip. But beyond that, let's think that you can have ultra-fast persistent disaggregated storage, which you are going to address in the, you know, latency microseconds. Okay, that's all. Can you do, you know, of course you can insert other layers, but how much you are going to benefit from these other layers? Expose control and trade-offs, I am running out of time. You know, here there are many trade-offs, latency versus accuracy, latency versus cost, security versus latency versus accuracy. And I just want to get here. So what are the tried and true techniques, right? First is sampling, and you can use it in scheduling, computation, storage, tail latency. Make your, if you have algorithms which are robust, to you know, to the data loss, you don't need to wait for everyone to get back to you before returning the results, right? And this happens everywhere, right? Even in search. Batching, right? You want to improve the throughput, you do batching, right? And you know that works. Speculation, right? It was said this is another way. You know, you are going to have small queries or whatever very fast. Just replicate them. The funny thing is that actually is working in many cases because although you have many, many of these small queries, in terms of how much computation resources they consume from the entire data center is tiny. So you can actually replicate. You can be generous there, right? And incremental, you know, incremental algorithms, incremental updates, machine learning. You are going to decompose to have some faster updates on the most fresher data, smaller models, and then combine with a much bigger model, which was computed on, trained on a bigger, older data. So in summary, we are at an inflection point, both in terms of application and hardware trends, sorry. And this means that we have a lot of opportunities. It's a very exciting times. But please be aware of complexity. You are talking about software, and software is hard to write. And maybe we can use some of these choices we have to simplify, to eliminate some of the components we have today, not to just add and add and add.
All right, let's thank our speaker.